Welcome to the Abraham Lincoln Institute Online Symposium. My name is Michelle A. Crowell, and I will serve as your host of this fourth and final program of the series. This live stream speaker symposium is focused on the life, times, and legacy of President Abraham Lincoln. You can learn more about the previously recorded programs in the symposium by visiting the Fords Theater website at www.fords.org or the Abraham Lincoln Institute website at www.lincoln-institute.org. A note to all our viewers, we are taking your questions on our social media platforms. Later in the program, we will have a Q&A section with today's speakers, moderated by my colleague, Jonathan W. White. Please feel free to submit your questions so that we may share them with the speakers then. Finally, the Abraham Lincoln Institute would like to take this opportunity to thank Paul Tatro, Erica Scott, Gary Erskine, Carolina Dulcey, Lauren B.A., Juliana Avery, Andrea Bowman, and the staff of Fords Theater for all their hard work to make this virtual symposium possible. Our first speaker is Tamika Nunley. Dr. Nunley is currently an associate professor of American history at Oberlin College and Conservatory in Ohio, although she will soon be joining the faculty in the history department of Cornell University. At Oberlin, she created the History Design Lab, which allows students to develop scholarly projects that involve methodological approaches, such as digital humanities, public history, creative nonfiction, and curatorial practices. Her research and teaching interests include slavery, gender, 19th century legal history, digital history, and the American Civil War. Her recent book, At the Threshold of Liberty, Women, Slavery, and Shifting Identities in Washington, D.C., examines African American women's strategies of self-definition in the context of slavery, fugitivity, courts, schools, streets, and the government during the Civil War era. She is currently completing a second book, The Demands of Justice, Enslaved Women, Capital Crime, and Clemency in Early Virginia, 1705 to 1865, to be published by the University of North Carolina Press. Speaking today on At the Threshold of Liberty, Black Women in Wartime Washington, we welcome Tamika Nunley to the program.
Thank you, Michelle, and thank you to the Abraham Lincoln Institute for having me today. I'll go ahead and begin. Throughout the American Civil War, African-American women and girls tested the scope of emancipation policies, leveraged the conditions of war, and redefined the meaning of liberty in the nation's capital. Legal emancipation began first in Washington, D.C. at the beginning of the war in 1862 and set off a series of legislative aftershocks that would gradually break down the stronghold of chattel slavery. The story of Black women and girls' liberty claims, however, began well before the outbreak of war. This evening, we'll begin with a classroom crowded with Black girls anxious to learn about politics. We will then weave into the alleyways of the district brothels where Black women sold sex and leisure, and then explore the journey of enslaved women who initiated a social contract with the federal government that would forever transform their relationship to the Union. These women and girls were driven by the ideals of their time and expressed their desires to govern their own lives without the oversight, force, and violence administered by others. Free Black women and girls faced limited access to economic and social mobility, but an education opened up possibilities for a vocation in teaching and participation in social reform. In Washington, schools were the spaces in which Black girls explored their own ideas, opinions, and values, not only about themselves, but the worlds in which they lived. In their learning, they were steeped in literature, science, theology, reform, and the heated political debates of the 1850s. In Mertilla Minor School for Colored Girls, one student, Marietta Hill, was particularly engrossed in the political affairs of the Union. In 1854, Congress passed the Kansas-Nebraska Act, which allowed those who settled in the territory to decide whether or not to permit slavery there. Girls like Marietta Hill remained attuned to the latest political debates about slavery, understanding that the fate of the institution shaped the contours of their own experiences in Washington. Hill shared that, quote, "Sometimes a dark cloud seems to overshadow me, and since the Nebraska bill has passed, the cloud appears thicker and darker, and I say, will slavery forever exist?" End quote. Slavery seemed to meet no end as Congress went back and forth with one compromise after the next. As long as slavery existed and African Americans lacked equal rights to citizenship, their lives remained circumscribed by severe legal and social parameters. But her resolve remained steadfast as she declared, quote, "It shall cease, it shall and must be abolished. I think there will be bloodshed before all can be free. And the question is, are we willing to give up our lives for freedom? Will we die for our people? We may say yes," end quote. Marietta's assessment of the political climate was eerily prophetic. Bloodshed, not just in Kansas, but on Harper's Ferry and eventually Fort Sumter, would usher the Union into war. In the meantime, Minor provided an intellectual environment that made space for the girls to share their thoughts and frustrations, as well as their candid opinions about the national state of affairs. They offered critiques that ranged from political events to everyday insults they experienced in Washington. Minor hoped to provide the kind of education that positioned the girls to articulate claims to equality in the Capitol. Making an education accessible to Black girls stirred social and political anxieties among white locals with the future of the country, concerned with the future of the country. Regarding the school for Black girls, the mayor of Washington pleaded that, quote, "We cannot tolerate an influence in our midst, which will not only constantly disturb the repose and prosperity of our own community and of the country, but may even rend asunder the Union itself," end quote. He appealed to the local government to wield their influence to undermine the work of Minor School. Lennox implored that, quote, "Such a protest, it is the duty of our corporate authorities to make. Its beneficent effect may be to persuade the supporters of this scheme to abandon its further prosecution," end quote. Lennox claimed that Minor and her students left white residents no choice, warning that, quote, "The responsibility will be with those who by their own wanton acts of aggression make resistance a necessity and submission an impossibility," end quote. Thus, the mayor of Washington validated the violent responses of white mobs that the girls confronted on a daily basis. Minor School inspired violent retaliatory responses that involved racist and sexist epithets aimed at the girls. One white pedestrian balked at a group of the students and referred to them as quote unquote impudent hussies and demanded that the landlady turn out the school or be mobbed, end quote. The use of the term hussies invoked sexualized imagery of seductresses and 19th century coquetry as though their very presence invited such insults. The man projected a sexualized and wayward representation of them in the broader public to justify their removal. Students' responses to local harassment do not appear in the existing record, but perhaps their thoughts remained in the purview of their private lives. Indeed, historian Darlene Clark Hine explained the ways that 19th century Black women embraced a culture of dissemblance, where they protected their inner lives and reactions to sexualized insults. These girls most likely deployed a number of strategies of survival, many exhibited by African American women within their respective communities. Sources allow us to see that students took seriously the work of learning and regarded such efforts as an indictment of the society that deprived them of the basic privileges afforded their white counterparts. When lectured by the white wife of a clergyman on the importance of being educated according to one's social status, one student responded, quote, "I would rather be learned than be contented and be ignorant. I will be learned. I must be learned. I would not ask this as colored people should not enjoy every right as white people," end quote. Lizzie's commitment to education coalesced with her claims to citizenship. This connection between learning, enlightenment, and rights underlines the pedagogical project of the Minor School. Minor hoped to provide the kind of education that positioned the girls to articulate claims to equality in the Capitol. In a context where few girls exercised the privilege of attending private school, and most Black girls were expected to serve at the pleasure of white families, the educational achievements of Black girls challenged the racial and gender hierarchies of the district. Once they graduated, they made tremendous sacrifices to form their own classrooms. In 1857, Anne E. Washington, a graduate of Minor School, opened a school nearby. Sources described Washington as a woman of refinement with an excellent aptitude for teaching. She gained notoriety for the way she operated her school, quote, "with a system and superior judgment, giving universal satisfaction, the number of her pupils being only limited by the size of her room," end quote. The room, located in her mother's home, speaks to the resourcefulness of Black women teachers who did not have access to the philanthropic connections that Minor employed. Washington's mother was a washerwoman who made limited income in a labor economy that relegated Black women to the bottom of the wage earning spectrum. Sources offer that her mother, quote, a widow woman, is a laundress and by her own labor has given her children good advantages, though she had no such advantages herself, end quote. The growth of the free African American population meant that Black women and girls increasingly contended with the limitations of liberty in the nation's capital. Indeed, they navigated social and economic challenges in different ways. Miners' girls were afforded opportunities to attend school, while some girls and women earned a living in the local entrepreneurial, sex, and leisure economies. Constrained and limited by economic opportunities, Black women and girls labored in enterprising and industrious ways, particularly at the outbreak of war. During the Civil War, prostitution positioned Black women and girls to begin to pay for basic living expenses in a city overcrowded with soldiers and refugees. The degree to which Black girls made the choice to enter into sex commerce was largely shaped by factors involving gender and racial inequality that limited their job prospects. Thus, sex work appears as either a short-term strategy or a long-term approach to economic mobility. African-American girls appeared in the news as the prey of older Black and white women working in sex and leisure. One such case involved a 16-year-old girl from Elmira, New York, who eloped with a soldier. Her mother learned that her daughter lived in Washington, so she sent an inquiry along with a likeness to the superintendent of the police department, and the detectives immediately recognized her as the young girl they had seen at 13th Street between C and D. They searched for the girl and learned that she sought treatment from a local hospital. After searching different brothels, the detectives proceeded to a house kept by Julia Fleet, who lived on 3rd Street between Maryland Avenue and B Street South. Detectives found the girl emaciated and seated near a window. As they entered the house, they found civilian men and women and soldiers playing cards upon their knees, as they had neither a table nor spare stool. In addition to the people playing cards, the detectives noticed that a number of ailing prostitutes were lying around. Officers returned the girl to her mother and reported that, quote, the distress of the mother when the wasted figure of her once beautiful daughter was brought into her presence was heartrending even to those accustomed to scenes of distress, end quote. In the news account, the girl appeared as a fallen soul who exhibited much sorrow and shame. These reports served as depictions of the dangers of vice and immorality that appeared in the city. But the story under the surface appears much more complicated. The realities of wartime poverty and the way that Black women in particular struggle to survive offer insights into how the girl arrived at Fleet's 3rd Street establishment. The ailing prostitutes found at Fleet's home affirm another detail of her life. Locals described Fleet as, quote, a sort of doctress for afflicted females of her class, end quote. The girl conceivably worked for Fleet, but there's a possibility she sought Fleet for medical care as well. When the detectives initially began their search for her, they learned that she went to a local hospital in search of treatment. Locals contracted diseases from the overcrowded and unsanitary conditions of the city. Women and girls in sex commerce were certainly vulnerable to venereal disease. Evidence only marginally supports that Fleet enticed the girl into her brothel, but the report sheds light on how these establishments served multiple functions, making space for sex, leisure, and socializing, but even serving the purposes of healing. These reports seldom explained details from the perspectives of Black women. Indeed, the record does not even provide a name for the girl. Stories like hers shed light on the fact that Black women experienced the war very differently depending upon their social and economic position. At the beginning of the war, the provost marshal recorded 450 registered body houses, and the Evening Star reported 5,000 prostitutes working in Washington City alone, not including the 2,500 women in Georgetown and Alexandria who worked in the wartime sex economy. A register kept by officials featured 12 colored body houses with addresses that were difficult to decipher because of their location, hidden among alley communities. Residential blocks in 19th century Washington typically included streets within the block that formed a T or H shape. More noticeable structures faced outwards towards the street, but behind the houses and buildings, inhabitants, particularly those associated with the quote-unquote lower classes, lived and congregated in the smaller configurations of the alleys. The alley streets typically measured 30 feet wide, and structures stood within much closer proximity to adjacent buildings. While solicitation occurred near Union military camps and along main thoroughfares with high foot traffic, the quarters in which sex and leisure took place existed beyond the prominent avenues and into the alleys where makeshift structures occupied by Black inhabitants remained out of sight. For instance, Mrs. Seal and Brown, Theodosia Herbert, Rebecca Gaunt, Sarah Wallace, and Josephine Webster appeared in the register with establishments located in the alleys. The record listed the number of inmates according to a hierarchy of race and status, with one being the best and low being the worst. Ranked pretty far down the list of establishments, the register shows two houses located in the rear of E Street. The rear typically indicated that structures existed closer to alleys. Although these two houses ranked lower on the scale, a place located in the alleys didn't always equate to lower status. Tin Cup Alley housed many Black and white body houses, including those operated by Theodosia Herbert, Rebecca Gaunt, and Sarah Wallace, who ranked in the first and second tiers. Tin Cup Alley served as a popular site of interracial sex and leisure enterprises that appealed to a broader range of clientele. Seal and Brown, on the other hand, managed their operation in Marble Alley, an enterprise regarded as a particularly low body house. A notorious site for prostitution, Marble Alley was nestled between Pennsylvania and Missouri Avenues within the crime-ridden district popularly known as Murder Bay. Similarly, Josephine Webster owned a place that employed 12 prostitutes in Fighting Alley, also known for crime. Webster most likely managed tight quarters that attracted a number of clients. This classification system may also serve as an indicator of the quote-unquote class standing of the patrons, but as the locations and rankings of Black women's establishments show, facilities, amenities, and the degree to which clients entered spaces that made them vulnerable to crime determined how clients and officials categorized Black-owned sites of sex and leisure. The marshal's attempts to document the list of body houses reveal the degree to which officials regarded the growth of the sex economy as an unwieldy enterprise to be controlled and surveyed. Even as the number of prostitutes in body houses increased, the establishments appeared more discreet with the conditions of overcrowding and the use of alley dwellings for such purposes. As soldiers and civilians moved in and out of the purview of city streets, officials struggled to keep track of every rendezvous of soldiers and Black prostitutes. The tension in Black women's work in criminalized and sexualized enterprises remains in the degree of autonomy afforded in working with relative flexibility and the subsequent sexual commodification, vulnerability to violence, and exploitation that came with it. As free Black women discovered entrepreneurial ways to take advantage of the wartime economy, the social and political transformations of the war led to the demise of slavery in Washington. The outbreak of war and the mobilization of the military not only transformed the dynamics of the local labor economy, but the Union's commitment to emancipation. On April 16, 1862, Abraham Lincoln signed a bill that abolished slavery and compensated slaveholders in Washington. In December of that same year, Emmeline Wedge filed petitions on behalf of herself, her two children, and her sister Alice Thomas, who were all enslaved on the property belonging to Alexander McCormick. McCormick refused to take advantage of the compensation provision of the new emancipation law, and Emmeline saw an opportunity. He reluctantly appeared before the clerk of the court after receipt of a summons. According to court records, McCormick, quote, denied the constitutionality of the Emancipation Act and said that he would bide his time until it was declared unconstitutional, end quote. Besides, he was a citizen with rights to property, and why would anyone take seriously claims made by an enslaved woman? Well, the Supplemental Act passed in the summer of 1862 permitted enslaved women in the District of Columbia to testify against white men and women for the first time. As an enslaved woman, Wedge challenged both the legal validity of her enslavement and, for the first time, forced McCormick to contend with her testimony against him. The facts of Emmeline Wedge's case revealed the unique geographic position of Washington, D.C. and the neighboring Chesapeake counties as a distinctive geopolitical battleground over liberty during the Civil War. Evidence showed that McCormick's farm was located along the border dividing the district from Maryland, and that just one day after the Emancipation Act became law, he instructed the slaves to reside on the Maryland side of his property. According to the records of the Board of Commissioners, he built a small tenement for them on the Maryland side, while his main living quarters remained in the district, along with a cow pen and other buildings included on the homestead. While McCormick generally prohibited enslaved people from traveling to the district side of the property, it was proven that Alice was required to drive cattle from the pasture to the cow pen, which was located on the district side. Unidentified witnesses also testified that they had seen the women and children in McCormick's Washington home daily, and that for approximately 7 or 8 weeks, Emmeline and her family resided in the district. The Board of Commissioners ultimately acknowledged Emmeline's right to claim freedom under the Emancipation Act of 1862. Ideas about liberty and bondage were tied to place, and Washington was changing. Women like Wedge assumed a new role, not completely carved out for them, but with anticipation and even hope for what could be. Throughout the course of wartime emancipation, refugee women and freed women navigated the power dynamics that made liberty possible in order to secure it for themselves and their kin. Former bondwomen employed their knowledge of the geographic and political significance of Washington as they approached officials of the government to make claims to liberty. These experiences were distinctive in how they transformed their own futures, as well as the significance of the nation's capital as a site of liberty. Throughout the course of the war, Black women litigated, petitioned, and organized in the capital. The legal and extra-legal steps they took to realize liberty set in motion an array of claims to their lives and labors. Refugee women who arrived in the capital during the Civil War did so at their own risk, confronting a system in which their legal status was deeply ambiguous. Refugee and fugitive women took advantage of the geographic and political position of Washington, D.C., particularly in instances where they arrived from slaveholding states during or after 1862. Many of them traveled to the district from Virginia, a bastion of the Confederacy, or Maryland, a loyal slaveholding state. According to the laws and customs of the Confederacy, Black women coming from Virginia were considered fugitives, and depending on one's views, refugees. With Virginia in rebellion, officials might be less sympathetic to Virginia's slaveholders, but an enslaved woman could never be sure. The intra-regional ties were strong, and locals with Southern sympathies likely undermined Black women's liberty claims if given the opportunity. Concerned with appeasing loyalists in Maryland, the federal government legally protected the interests of slaveholders in the state by upholding the Fugitive Slave Law of 1850. Depending on whether the laws of the Confederacy or the Union applied, Black women traveling from slaveholding states could be considered enslaved even as wartime emancipation took its course. Thus, Black women remained in a state of legal limbo as they navigated wartime policy created in the interests of states loyal to the Union and against the interests of the Confederacy. In many instances, slaveholders hoped to entice parents to remain on farms by withholding children. As a result, Black women sometimes took matters into their own hands in order to retrieve their children from the grips of planter exploitation and create a life where their families could enjoy the fruits of their own labors. Jane Camper, a former bondwoman who belonged to William Townsend of Talbot County, Maryland, reportedly told Mr. Townsend, quote, "of my having become free and desired my master to give my children and my bedclothes. He told me that I was free, but that my children should be bound to him," end quote. She testified further that, quote, "he locked my children up so that I could not find them. I afterwards got my children by stealth and brought them to Baltimore," end quote. Camper, like many other freed women, risked her life to save her children by stealth from unconsented apprenticeship. She concluded her statement saying, quote, "my master pursued me to the boat to get possession of my children, but I hid them on the boat," end quote. As Camper's story reveals, the Union government made the freedom of Black women and children lawful, but not always tangible. Even upon assuming freedom rights gained from the war, Black women continued the work of resituating their relationship between themselves, the government, and the communities in which they lived. The stories of these women do not fit into neat historiographical themes, but show the rather complicated and unanticipated directions in which their lives took shape. This history of Black women does not fit neatly in the American this history of Black women does not frame American liberty in exceptional terms, but instead tells a story about the obstacles that come with the ways that slavery, race, and gender posed barriers to liberty and the manner in which Black women and girls in Washington responded. Throughout the course of the war, Black women forged a dynamic relationship between themselves and the government, and they combated both white resistance and violence and searched for family, housing, and jobs. Liberty remained a work in progress.
Our second distinguished speaker today is C.R. Gibbs, the author or co-author of 6 books, including Black, Copper, and Bright, The District of Columbia's Black Civil War Regiment, and Black Inventors, From Africa to America, 2 Million Years of Invention and Innovation. He wrote, researched, and narrated Sketches in Color, a 13-part companion series to the acclaimed PBS series, The Civil War, for WHUT-TV, the Howard University television station. He is a frequent lecturer on a variety of historical topics and has appeared numerous times on national and international television programs. In 1989, he founded the African History and Culture Lecture Series, whose scholars provide free presentations at libraries, churches, and other locations in the Washington-Baltimore area. In 2009, the Congressional Black Caucus Veterans Brain Trust honored Mr. Gibbs for his more than three decades of articles, exhibits, and presentations on the military heritage of Africans and African Americans. And now to speak on the Underground Railroad in Washington, D.C., we are delighted to welcome C.R. Gibbs to the program.
Hello, let me thank everyone, particularly the Abraham Lincoln Institute and its staff and employees. It's important that you understand at the beginning that the Underground Railroad is a golden chapter in the history of human endeavor. Despite its risks, despite its dangers, it demonstrates an amazing degree of interracial cooperation. Upon its pages are inscribed actions by men, women, and children, making them and marking them as bold, courageous, and brave. The Underground Railroad swirled around the life of Abraham Lincoln, and not only in Washington, D.C., which is the main focus of my talk today, but even in small Springfield, Illinois. We know that, for example, Jameson Jenkins, who was a conductor on the Underground Railroad in Springfield, lived on A Street, the same block that the president and his wife lived. In Washington, D.C., the activities of the Underground Railroad would grow more than fourfold. And we know that it impacted Lincoln in 1855. Before he came to the nation's capital, he said he hated to see the poor devils hunted down. But he was a believer in property rights, and that was supreme to him. He would comment on it several more times during his life. But my mission this afternoon is to take you to the Underground Railroad in Washington, D.C. And our first image is one of the singular institutions in that enterprise, and that is Asbury Methodist Church. Founded in 1836, it was a linchpin in the free Black community and a mainstay in terms of offering services to the enslaved community in the nation's capital. It was at 11th and K, where it still is today, and many of its parishioners were also members of one of the boldest attempts at freedom in the local history of the Underground Railroad. And that is, of course, perhaps better known as the Pearl Affair. 173 years ago, this past spring, it was where the planning of an incredibly audacious attempt at freeing not simply one or a handful of enslaved people, but more than 70. The discussions began here. Members of the congregation were participants. And we see that in this Pearl Affair, which today is commemorated at 1701 Duke Street in Old Town Alexandria, you will when you get there because it's right across the street from Whole Foods, you'll get a sense of at least the compelling stories of the Edmondson sisters. But of course, this attempt at slavery was more than just the activities of two freedom-seeking Black women. Black women's courageousness is writ all throughout the existence of the Underground Railroad in the nation's capital, and we'll talk about a few of them as our story goes on. The activities, for example, of Lucinda Clark Bush, who was one of the conductors, if you will, a member not of the stately Asbury Methodist Church, but also the Second Baptist Church, a institution founded in 1848, which still extant, as is Asbury. The Second Baptist Church exists today. just off of 3rd and Massachusetts Avenue. It fell to Lucinda Clark Bush, Lucy as she was sometimes known, to help get all of these people, more than 70, down to the DC Wharf. That would be the point of departure. And it would be a place where the ship had come in, a small schooner had recently carried coal amid the dust and dirt of the hold of the ship. These people decided that freedom would be the lodestar. It would be everything that they risked their lives for. And they were able to get about 150 miles downriver before the weather gave them away. The winds went slack, their sails died down, and they were left near Cornfield Harbor. Almost, it seemed to them, I have no doubt, an inch within that turn into the bay and their ultimate travel north. Well, the slave owners had not trusted the fate of their enslaved people to the vagaries of the wind. No, they sent a steamboat after them called the Salem out from the port of Georgetown, and it caught up with them. It overtook the Pearl, and they were returned to D.C. In fact, the tumult that was caused as a result of this unequivocal desire by Black people to be free helped to sweep at least some of the chatter that went on while the participants in the pro-slavery dialogues like to say that freedom-seeking Black folks suffered from a disease, that the disease was known as drapetomania. No, there was no sign of infirmity among these brave souls. And two of the women, the Edmondson sisters that would be so well known and were so stoutly chronicled by Dr. Nunley in the previous presentation would be have their futures attached to at least one of them to the school by our good friend Myrtilla Minor. But back to the women, the two of the Edmondson sisters who would be sold to a slave owner in Alexandria. This particular man, Bruin, was not simply a man who was interested in selling to farmhands. No, he had a connection with the placage system, a system of enforced prostitution in New Orleans. These attractive sisters, the Edmondson girls, would be sold there. But an outbreak of yellow fever required that the sisters soon be returned to the Bruin slave pen at what is now 1701 Duke Street in Old Town Alexandria. And they would be kept there. And while they were kept, there was a national campaign to rescue these individuals from the more horrible aspects of slavery. Sometimes we don't fully appreciate how the force of sex and the profits to be gained from it moved the institution of slavery in this country. But they would ultimately be free. And while most of the members of the passenger list on the Pearl would be sold into deep slavery and other locations, yet the courage and fortitude of the Edmondson sisters would remain a beacon for many years to come. Our next image, as we go along, talks about yet another institution. And of course, I'm referring to Mount Zion Methodist Church. As we look at the cemetery, we see a long-standing testament to the courage of the African-American community in the town of George. One of the other books that I've been my honor to co-author was Black Georgetown Remembered. And in it, we explore the history of Mount Zion Methodist Church. We also take a look at its graveyard, these pillars of stone, these testaments to the strength of the Black community to exist in spite of crushing oppression, remain with us. They inspire us. They call to us in this garden of stone. We know that on the far side of this cemetery, there was a burial vault that served as a place where freedom-seeking Black folk could hide before they were smuggled down to the waterfront at the bottom of the hill and put on ships toward freedom's bosom. Can you imagine wanting something that badly that even in the wintertime, you would spend nights among coffins and urns in order to get your freedom? This is one of the significant lessons that we have for freedom-seeking people and why the lesson of the Underground Railroad in the nation's capital and throughout the North and South stands as a reminder of the ultimate strength of the human condition and its desire among all people to be free and to have a measure of control over their destiny. When we look at Mount Zion Cemetery, we see the inscriptions on stone and are reminded of generations of Black people that in many ways worked on the Underground Railroad, had relatives that used the Underground Railroad to get away free. And the church records often have notations about gone away, which we believe was a notation speaking to the idea of the person gone away on the Underground Railroad. We know as well that the Georgetown waterfront, which is our next image, had been a place of enslavement. We now know that it's part of Georgetown's earliest history. Georgetown had been a slave port, a very active slave port. But now, in a reversal of this role, that would also be a place of rescue as actors on the Underground Railroad moved their human cargo aboard ships with courageous captains and unbelievably bold crewmen to get them into freedom. We also take a look now at DC writ large. And that is a map of the city. And we're going to go sort of around town, if you will, and take a look at some of the ways that the Underground Railroad operated. If you come with me now to 19th Street in Foggy Bottom, we are reminded of the 19th Street Baptist Church, which for more than a century was a linchpin in the Black community in Foggy Bottom. It was a place that was active in the Underground Railroad. It was also a place in which the free Black community worked with its enslaved brethren to forge links to a Black community that would last in Foggy Bottom well after the last auctioneer's block fell in the nation's capital. We also are aware that going back up to Second Baptist Church, the Second Baptist Church was active off of 3rd and Massachusetts. The precise address was 816 3rd Street. And I mentioned Lucinda Bush Clark, who helped to round up the people in for the Pearl. But she was one of many. Elizabeth Smallwood was yet another African-American woman who we know about her exploits on the local Underground Railroad because her husband, Thomas Smallwood, wrote a narrative about their activities. And during the 1840s, they moved more than 150 freedom seekers out of the misery that was slavery in Washington, D.C. and the surrounding Maryland counties into the glories of what would be freedom in Canada and other places. We must consider other dangers that afflicted the people who sought to use the Underground Railroad. In your mind's eye, I would have you come with me now to what would one day be Georgia Avenue, but in these days, it is August the 8th, it is 1850, and a carriage late at night is zooming out of the city toward what today would be the intersection of Georgia Avenue and Eastern Avenue. If you go there today, there's a small park. If you have a moment, pull over and to Jessup Blair Park, if you would, if you have the time, and look for a wayside exhibit that talks about the fateful events of August the 8th, 1850. You see, coming from the district would be a two-person carriage, and driving it would be a white abolitionist named Chaplin. He did not know that there would be a posse waiting for him just as he crossed the line into Maryland. That posse, if you will, that gaggle of slave hunters would be so filled with bloodlust that they stabbed the doors of the coach. They fired into the coach, seeking to recapture two black men, Garland and Allen. And these were not ordinary field hands. Please understand this. They were the legal property of two of the most famous defenders of slavery in the United States Senate. They had to be recaptured. They had to be made to understand the error of their ways, because after all, their owners in the Senate had talked about how slavery was good for black people. And this gave the lie to that. And they would be returned, as Chaplin would be, to the district, Maryland, and the district would contend over who's going to put this man on a show trial, to use a 20th century term. But the events of that night echoed throughout the entire operation of the Underground Railroad. So when you get a chance, go there, if you would, please, just to the intersection of Georgia and Eastern Avenue. I would also have you, as we're driving around the city in our vehicle that doesn't have to observe traffic or parking rules, come with me to 22nd and 8th Streets Northwest. There is a brushy area at 22nd and 8th, and I want you just to step off the curb. Right as you walk into that corner, there is a plaque on the ground. And on that plaque, you will see that it commemorates the house of one of the most effective conductors on the Underground Railroad. I won't tell you his name. I will ask you to go and see it and read about it. And so you'll learn about this man. He was a hack driver, one of the few occupations open to black men in the district. And he took people out of D.C. as far away as Loudoun County. He would ultimately, because of his efficacy as a smuggler to freedom's doorstep, be forced to leave this area. In fact, the Bushes coming out of Second Baptist would have to leave this area as well. To understand fully, we go back to the story of Georgia and Eastern Avenue, and we know that the slave owners employed a group of people also known as slave hunters. D.C. had, in for black people in those days, it was an oppressive society. It was a police state where their every move was watched. And one of the men leading the group of slave hunters that night of August 1850 was a man named Goddard, who was already known to the people who were helping work on the Underground Railroad. Here was an iron-faced man who, it seemed to take a savage glee into catching black folk. His minions were known to stand outside black churches and to wait for the 10 o'clock horn or bell and snatch black people up off the street in an effort to bring them to the magistrate. This kind of behavior astonished the English author Charles Dickens in American Notes, which he writes in the 1840s, that black people walking down the street could be accosted by any constable. They didn't need to be doing anything wrong. They did not need to sunder a single ordinance. It seemed as though the color of their skin, for what other evidence would they have that they were escaping slaves? When you try to unravel the nettlesome equation of Black relations with the police. You must come back to these times, or you will never fail to completely understand that from the coming of this country, Black people were seen as people that needed to be surveilled, they needed to be watched, they needed to be apprehended for doing nothing more simply than going about their daily a task and wishing, most of all, for those who were enslaved to be free. Dickens reminds us that in the city named after Washington, that was already accumulating a reputation as a country, the land of the free and the home of the brave, in D.C., a Black person could be apprehended and then taken to jail. But your question is obviously, what if he is a free Black man? Who's going to come and claim him when they advertise him in the newspapers? And you're right, no one's going to come and claim him. He will then be sold to pay jail fees. Such was the reputation of Washington, D.C. during these inhospitable times that I ran across an 1844 article in the Australian Literary Journal that talks about a Black man snatched off the streets, alleged to be an escaping slave. He was a free Black man. He did not have his papers, and you would think that he would be let go. No. The Australian Literary Journal tells us that he was sold to pay jail fees. These are the risks. Moreover, in 1839, a young boy named Jim was apprehended, as they said, lurking about the Capitol. He wouldn't tell them what he was doing there, but they soon believed he was trying to get away on the Underground Railroad. So they convinced him to tell them even more by dragging him to a local blacksmith shop. And they tortured him. They tortured him by putting his fingers in a blacksmith vise. I don't know how many of you might be familiar with Westerns, but if you know about a blacksmith shop, you can imagine how quickly a place to shoe horses and to care for them and to feed them could be turned into a torture chamber. And this is what happened in August of 1839 for a man we only know as Boy Jim. This is one of the risks of the Underground Railroad. And yet, those who sought freedom, be they from Virginia or Maryland or in the district itself, which was regarded by many as the southern terminus of one leg of the Underground Railroad, they were willing to do everything. And that simply wasn't limited to people that we don't know. We know, for example, that no less than William H. Seward, a member of Lincoln's cabinet, worked with one of the leaders of the free Black community, James Wormley. James Wormley, who they worked together during the Civil War while both men were in Washington to bring freedom-seeking people from the James River area to Washington, D.C. It is my hope that you will understand and appreciate that this required the greatest of secrecy. There are still people whose families have told me stories about their work on the Underground Railroad, which they cannot and do not feel fully safe to divulge even now, after legal slavery has been buried. Before I close, I want to just mention Georgetown for a second. Some of slavery's most horrible images came out of that tiny community. And it's worth noting that there are institutions in Georgetown that were part of the slaveocracy and still are there today. Georgetown University, as it was known in those days, Georgetown College, not only engineered a sale of more than 200 enslaved people, most of whom were in Louisiana, but we know that there are escape posters from Georgetown University, that there were slave sales in Georgetown's along some of its busiest streets. So Georgetown doesn't escape this kind of history either. And I'd like to end with an observation by Frederick Douglass, which is that no man can tell the intense agony which is felt by the slave when wavering on the point of making his escape. All that he has is at stake, and even that which he has not is at stake also. The life which he has may be lost, and the liberty he seeks may not be gained. Perhaps then one crucial lesson from the history of the Underground Railroad is that, yes, indeed, Black folk were willing to risk the ultimate for what they perceived their lives, for the ultimate price, freedom. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much to you both for those wonderful presentations. I want to remind our viewers at home that you can post questions on social media and they'll get sent to us here so that our speakers can address them. And we actually just got our first question in, so that's perfect timing. This is for Tamika. You talked about Black women being able to testify in court against white men and women for the first time. Can you speak more about the importance of that and the impact of that change in American law?
Yeah, for sure. Most of the time leading up to the Civil War, Black women, particularly enslaved Black women, were not permitted to testify against white Americans. They were deposed, right? And so in that sense, you can get some information about their perspectives. But for the most part, right, they were barred from being able to testify against slaveholders. And so the Supplemental Act, which was passed after the DC Emancipation Act, allowed for enslaved women to testify for the first time against slaveholders who either refused compensation, refused to acknowledge the Emancipation Act, or even who try to force their children into apprenticeship agreements through the orphans courts. And so this was really a seminal moment when DC allowed for emancipation, but legislators soon realized that there needed to be some follow-up legislation that made this more tangible. And so Black women were then able to mobilize that new Supplemental Act in their interest.
I wanted to ask you as well, you have a whole chapter on courts. Can mm-hmm. you talk about the other kinds of experiences that Black women are facing in court, the charges that they're facing throughout the early republic?
Yes, for sure. So I look at courts in very distinct ways, right? And so I think that there's a way in which historians can write about courts to focus and emphasize Black women's liberty claims. And so I include some stories that feature Black women making claims to freedom through the law and using the courts to do that. And I think William Thomas's new book does that even more than my book and does that more in depth. But then I also see the courts not just as a site of liberation, but as a site of surveillance and criminalization, right? And so for Black women who maybe cannot find jobs, right, or end up working in sex and leisure, they end up in the courts as well for very different reasons. And so the point of that chapter is to complicate how we see the courts, to see it in its complexity, in its context, and also see it at an individual level where Black women are approaching the court or forced into the court for very different reasons.
Yeah, that's great. CR, we got our first question for you. And the question is, you mentioned that a lot of the people, the leaders of the Underground Railroad in DC were women. And this person asked if you could speak more about the role of women in the Underground Railroad, how they might have acted as leaders.
I am constantly amazed that these Black women were able to, if you will, finesse the patriarchal notion of the churches and oftentimes their husbands to engage in work that many considered absolutely sacred. And we understand that we can sort of typify this if we look at the activities of the Edmondson sisters, for example, and more importantly, their mother. And I have in a lecture that I do on DC emancipation, the description of a mother who saw her child beaten for attempting to escape on the Underground Railroad. And I believe it's from a paper called the Washington Independent. And while you read how the mother fussed at her child for taking such a risk, She, at the same time, seems to betray a moment of pride in the courage of her daughter, and understanding perhaps more so than her young child, everything that she had to go through in order to get to where she would have the courage to step out on the Underground Railroad. And what we see is that the Black women were able to use the institutions inside the church, if you will, as circles of activity that assisted them in organizing as well as propagating the news about attempts at escape. So these are ways in which, despite the dangers that they had to go through, that they were able to use the system, often inside the churches, to get information out. In the case of Lucinda Bush, to go get folk, to go down to the wharf. And given the level of oppression and suspicion by which the movements of Black people were regarded in this city, we needn't talk about in the Deep South, but even in this city, I find it quite remarkable.
Yeah, I recently watched Henry Louis Gates's wonderful documentary on the Black Church. And one of the things he talks about is the way that African-American women are able to bring about social reform and transformation through the institution of the church. So that's fascinating to hear that that was part of this Underground Railroad story as well.
Yes.
Tamika, we have a question about the woman who is looking over your shoulder there. Can you talk about Elizabeth Keckley?
Yes, for sure. So a central theme in the book is Black women and girls engaging in acts of self-making. And so they're trying to define life on their terms. They're trying to present themselves in ways that are really important to them and speak to their truth, their values, right? And no one does this better than Elizabeth Keckley, who really goes from being an enslaved woman who cultivates this tremendous gift at dressmaking and is able to mobilize that gift to purchase her freedom and the freedom of her son, and then goes on to become a leading voice in Civil War Washington. And so a feature of the book is that Black women are occupying different statuses, right? And so DC is interesting in that you could see enslaved women, you can see fugitive women, you can see free women, right? And they occupy these various statuses and their life changes over time. And so the book tries to make space for those changes. And so Keckley's life, right, very much represents what that trajectory could look like, right? And what happens when Black women are able to define life on their terms. And so she's very cognizant of how she presents herself. She is very intentional and strategic about the kinds of organization she creates, the kind of church she attends, right? She's very selective about her clients. And even the cover of the book, the dress that she adorns, right, is very meticulously put together and even staged. And I think in some ways is a visual representation of kind of the concept running through the book, and that's that of self-making.
I'm curious, did she attend 15th Street Presbyterian
Church? Yes, she did. Yep.
She did, yeah. I mean, that's one of the centers of Black activism. Henry Highland Garnett is the pastor for the second half of the war, and yeah.
That's great.
That's great. Let's see, we got another question for you, CR, and this one is about the infirmity that escapees were able to suffer from or thought to suffer from. The question is, what infirmities did they suffer from? Could you talk a little bit more about that aspect of their struggles to become free?
Sure. The powers that be were aware of the image of enslavement and sought to mitigate that by trying to suggest that they had doctors who could put labels on this that would take away from the dichotomy of freedom or slavery. So Dr. Samuel Cartwright writes in the Bowes Review, which is a kind of Time magazine of slavery, that freedom-seeking Black folks suffered from drapetomania. And I'm pronouncing it like that so you will get a sense of how to spell drapetomania. It is the desire to want to run away. And the insidious thing about this is that it's an attempt to steal agency from Black people, as if we don't know the difference between freedom and oppression, that if we recognize something, it must be a virus. It must be some sort of pathogen that's making us do this, because we wouldn't do it otherwise, of course. And so he, Cartwright, and several others of his ilk came up with a raft of fake diseases. Another one is diesthesia ethiopica, or hebetude of the mind, which made us want to break tools and put ground glass in master's buttermilk and things like that. In other words, again, not that we had a conscious desire to it, but that it was some pathogen pushing us to make these kinds of actions, which of course is ridiculous. But again, we know that there was a pro-slavery lobby, and they were concerned with, to a certain extent, the public image of it, which is why for so long, and even today, people want to foist upon us images of the happy, contented, dancing darkie on the slave plantation.
Were those fake diseases developed after the 1830s, when abolitionism is beginning to really grow as a movement, or do they go back to the 18th or early 19th century?
You know, we see them rise with sort of an organized emphasis, the 1830s or so. I understand that the American Psychiatric Association has begun to apologize for being part of that. The Samuel Cartwright, infamous in this activity, was a member in good standing of what would come to be the American Psychiatric Institute. And so much of their early work has to be disregarded because it was based on false notions of Black humanity. And luckily, at least now, they've begun to apologize for it.
That's interesting. Tamika, we got a question for you about the sex work that Black women and girls engaged in. You mentioned that was a financial stopgap for Black women. Was it common for them to be able to get financially stable enough to leave that line of work?
So it's interesting. Once the women that I've seen in the record become sort of known as a higher level body house, maybe that can demand higher prices. They don't leave. Actually, that's more incentive to stay. Whereas sometimes during the war, because of the conditions of war and the influx of soldiers and politicians to the nation's capital and their families, the crowding of refugees means that there's less jobs. It means that there are sort of desperate conditions. And so that becomes kind of a way to survive during the war, right? So for some women, right, it's the wartime, right? They're escaping from other parts of the South. They're making their way to the nation's capital. The conditions in some of the camps are not ideal, right? And I'm thinking about Barker's camp, right? Mm-hmm. And so it's not like Freedman's Village, right? And so they venture out into the streets, right? And they venture out into the streets to pursue sex work to survive. But then there are some that begin to create enterprises that look more like a parlor style body house, very very much like some of the white women who cater to some of the elite men of the city, where you're creating kind of setting a scene of domesticity, right? In this fantasy of being a part of an elite household, an elite intimate household. And so some of the Black women who engage in those kinds of enterprises oftentimes remain because it is profitable. And so what it forces us to do is think more fluidly about self-making, right? And I think traditionally we have thought about Black women in terms of education and leadership and social reform, but we haven't really thought a lot about sex work and how it provides an avenue to survival and financial independence, even as it comes with risks of violence and exploitation. And so I say this in the book, you know, to leave prostitution out would leave it generically absent. And right. I really believe that because it's this huge industry, right, that's employing Black women.
Yeah, wow. CR, this one is for you. And you talked about the tragedy of free Black people being arrested and sold into slavery to pay for their jail fees. And this questioner wondered, were there any legal protections for African Americans who were accused of being enslaved when they were actually free, or who were arrested and jailed and then had to pay these fees?
DC gained a reputation for being dangerous for Black people. And several northern states passed what were called personal liberty laws to sort of give them some sort of recompense in a way. But the problem is that once you're caught up in the maw of this system, people lose contact with you. You might be lost for a time. And so my go-to example is Solomon Northup. You know, I mean, he is a free Black man lured to Washington, D.C. New York has the makings of a personal liberty law, but that doesn't help him. And so he winds up 12 years enslaved because he is lured down here. His papers are stolen. He is drugged and then carried across the mall and put on a vessel at the Southwest Wharf for more than a decade of horrible, barbarous enslavement in Louisiana.
Yeah, I was actually going to ask you about that. You mentioned the slave hunters and now Solomon Northup. Can you talk more about the kidnapping problem in Washington and in the North, what some people have called the reverse Underground Railroad? I mean, how common is Northup's experience in D.C.?
All too common. Again, for it to be mentioned in an Australian literary journal, you know, you kind of know that there may have been something going on before that. And so it was in the district, and not just simply visitors to the district. We have a man named Michael Schenner, who worked at the Washington Navy Yard, who sold fruits and vegetables at Eastern Market. And then in the 1830s, he comes home from work and his family has disappeared. Hmm. His entire family is gone. They had sold to Franklin and Armfield Slave Prison at 1315 Duke Street in Old Town Alexandria. And with a degree of understatement remarkable, even for that time, he mentions the pain of having to walk. And if people are familiar with DC, imagine having to walk from, let us say, the Navy Yard or Eastern Market all the way down across the 14th Street Bridge. And at the end of the 14th Street Bridge, you're still not in Alexandria. And he did that three times in one day. Every step must have been the most insane torture for him. But he had to see if his family was there, and they were in the slave pen. And then his job after that is, I mean, he says, again, with that remarkable understatement, and, you know, and with the assistance of God, I got my wife and children clear. Well, it also took money. He had to borrow money. And in the next passage, he says, I am now under 10,000 obligations. It may not have been literally $10,000, but he now owed people money that he had borrowed to free his family. He had to pay to get his own family free. And this is an extraordinary, we're just lucky to have this in his diary so that we can know about some of the travails in the lives of free Blacks who lived in Washington, D.C.
Yeah, I'm reminded shortly after the Pearl incident, which you talked about, there was an African-American waiter who worked at Mrs. Spriggs's boarding house where the Library of Congress now sits, who was kidnapped, and that came to the floor of Congress. Can you talk a little bit about that?
We believe that Anna Spriggs, and if you're at all familiar with D.C., her boarding house occupied one of the satellite buildings of the Library of Congress. Probably the Adams Building, we think. And Lincoln was boarding there, and he learned about this Black man who we learned was a short time away from buying his freedom. Can you imagine? Freedom is almost within your reach, and then you're snatched back into slavery. His journey, his trial, just again personifies the dangers of living as a free Black person. And we have among the police reports of the city in 1855, several black men, were caught out perhaps a bit after 10 p.m. when black people had to be off the street. And James Olmsted, the landscape architect, puts this down in his book, Journey Through the Seaboard Slave States. They were swept up. In this case, there was nothing illegal about what they were doing. They were meeting. One of them had a constitution of a printed society, which was said to relieve the sick and bury the dead. They had a subscription paper to try and collect money for the freedom of a young woman named Eliza Howard. They were locked up. Some of the enslaved men with them that night were flogged by the magistrate, and the others had to pay fines. Again, this is real life in D.C. prior to D.C. emancipation.
Yeah. Wow. Tamika, we got another question for you, and this one has to do about the educational opportunities that Black women and girls had in Washington. Can you talk about a little more about what their education looked like? And one of the things I would love to hear more about too is what sort of records you use to find out about the educational experiences they had?
Yeah, so the records that I found were at the Library of Congress, Myrtilla Minor's papers, and also the Cook family papers, which had really extensive documentation at Moreland Spingarn at Howard University on Black schools, but also just learning and researching people's profiles of that time was really helpful as well. Catholic records are also really important for that, the genealogy of that history. And in studying education, actually, that was one of my favorite chapters to write in the book, mainly because it really demystified some of the assumptions I made about education in DC. And so one of the first things to note is that it's not illegal for enslaved people to learn to read and write in DC. It's not desired and it's not desirable if you're a slaveholder, right? And you certainly have the legal authority to punish an enslaved person for doing something you don't want them to do within your household. But writ large, if enslaved people were going to school and learning, right, they could sneak off, but they oftentimes didn't have the time to do that. But all that to say that the schools catered to enslaved people covertly and cater to free Black residents overtly, right? And sometimes covertly, depending on how controversial the school appeared. So Minor School was targeted by the mayor. And, you know, as I mentioned in my paper, right, the mayor says that this is a threat to the actual union, right? And I was like, whoa, like when I found that in the record, I thought that was wild. And I found that in newspapers. But education was a collective enterprise. It was very much shaped by mutual aid. And so many of the schools were able to exist because of the collective effort of both women and men who are pulling their resources together to be able to provide an education for their community. And it was also varied in age. There were schools that were for adults, working adults, right, who perhaps cannot go to school during the daytime. And then there were schools for children who were part of this sort of emerging Black middle class set of families. And so they varied in age, they varied in legal status. Some of them were in people's houses, some of them were in church basements, some were in actual buildings that were specifically designed for schools. And so it varied. And what you saw was just this tremendous effort on behalf of everyone in DC. Particularly the Black community, to really mobilize resources to create as many schools as they possibly could. And so the idea was that if you attended one of these schools as a young kid, that maybe one day you would become a teacher or principal of one of those schools as well. And so it was creating an activist educational tradition in DC.
Right. Wow, that's incredible. And you see that really then explode during the Civil War years when Black African-Americans become teachers in missionary societies, hoping to train people to go out and teach others. Yeah, yeah,
they're ready.
They are. That's right. Well, we are out of time. I want to thank you both for joining us today for your wonderful remarks. I want to commend your books to everyone at home, to Tamika Nunley at the Threshold of Liberty. And I don't have CR what you've written on the Underground Railroad, but I do have Black, Copper, and Bright, which is a history of the first USCT, which was a black regiment raised in Washington, D.C. Two wonderful books that I highly recommend to our viewers at home. I want to thank Ford's Theater for hosting this over the past 8 weeks. It's been wonderful to get to continue the Abraham Lincoln Institute Symposium, even if we can't do it in person. But I do want to say that I hope we will be able to do it again in person at Ford's Theater in March of 2022. So for all of you who have joined us, thank you so much. And thank you again to Ford's.
Thank you.